Right.
Okay. Hello, my name's Sarah. I actually don't know if this is going to be 12 to 15 minutes, so I apologize if it's a bit shorter. I didn't plan the timing. Okay, so since a lot of you don't know me, my name's Sarah. I came from North Carolina. I actually used to go to this church before I moved about 7-8 years ago, so it's been a while. I came with my friend Hesia, right over there, and my brother. And I grew up in the church. My parents became Christians when they moved here to the U.S. And after I was born, I went to like the church's preschool. I went to their kindergarten class. I went to their elementary program, and then I went to their middle school program. And then when I moved to North Carolina, I went to I met my current church at their high school program. And so, let's see. I first became a dedicated Christian about 3 years ago. Because I don't, a lot of people who, especially like me, who grew up in the church, you're brought up with a lot of Christian knowledge. So you know God your Savior, Jesus died for you, you have to pray to him all the time, but you don't necessarily take it into your heart. And so about 3 years ago, my brother and my parents decided to get baptized. And so then I decided, you know what, I think it's my turn too. And so I decided then that I wanted to dedicate myself to God. And so then I started, after I got baptized, I started reading the Bible more often. I started praying more often. I talked to God a lot more. I kept asking him to show himself to me, to reveal himself to me in what I did every day. And yeah, I tried to read my Bible consistently. It doesn't always work out very well for me. I don't know why. I guess apparently a lot of y'all have the same trouble. Bible reading has, consistent Bible reading has always been a problem for me. I don't know why. But then not long after, I think I stopped. It wasn't that I stopped feeling God's presence. It's that I stopped relying on him as much. And so kind of like what Pastor was saying, after you're reborn again, you really want to desire God, but then whether it's because you don't feel him as much, or you don't think he's answering your prayer, or, let's see, what else did I write here? Or he's not answering the way you want him to, you stop trying to rely on him as much. And kind of like what the pastor was saying, he stops being as true to you as he once was. And so for a while, I had stopped praying as much as I used to. I almost stopped reading my Bible. I didn't really read my Bible at all. and like I said, I stopped going to church for a while, whether it was because of work or homework. I kept making excuses not to go to church. And the church I was going to at the time, it was a really small church, actually smaller than the youth program you all have now. It was about 4 people. And so it was a really close church, but we kept switching youth leaders, and so it was kind of disconnected at the same time. And so I kept making excuses not to go. And so that went on for a little bit. And then fast forward to last year, my family had stopped going to church, or like my brother and I stopped going to church for about a couple of months or so, or a good amount of time. And then all of a sudden my mom says, I really want you to go to church again. So she took us to a church called Raleigh Chinese Christian Church, or RCCC. And the first day, I remember she told me, you can come here for a few months or for a month or so, and if you don't like it, you can switch churches. Because there was like an American church I'd wanted to try out or something. But the first day I got there, the worship team needed a singer. And so I got volunteered. And so I got stuck singing for that worship team. So I couldn't leave after that. so essentially I got pulled into being stuck at church. And but I'm at that church now. And then so after being a part of their worship team and after being with their youth group, I've started to notice that their youth group is very passionate for God, whether it's because of their pastor, whether it's because of just the students themselves. Everyone seems to really want to learn about God. And so as a person who had a lot of influence from society and from my friends who weren't Christians. It was kind of new to me. And it reminded me of when I first became a Christian and I thought, God is real and I really want to know about God. And I had lost that sometime when I stopped like going to church and stopped reading the Bible and stuff. And so after I had moved to church, I could start seeing God acting in ways, like in other students, not necessarily in my own life, but like we would go on mission trips and then people would see God act through the like the things we did. Like we would go on, what's one thing we did? It was like a arts festival or something, and we would go out and we would talk to the people, we would do crafts with the kids. But what like I pulled out from there was people would come to us and we would tell them about God and they would listen, and then they would be kind of intrigued, and then God would kind of act on them a little bit, and then they would come back to us and be like, oh, thank you for telling me about God, I now go to this church and it's all great. But a lot of people, I saw a lot of the students take away from that, and a lot of students who weren't believers became believers. And so I saw God transform people's lives like that. And so people who used to be kind of like rowdy, kind of detached from the church, were now very intimate with the church. Like they were very intimate with God, they were very involved. And so I was like, I really want that to happen to me. Because I had recognized that I was very detached from God. Like I had stopped, I didn't stop, I knew he was there, but I didn't really talk to him as much as I used to. And so I started to pray a lot more. I started to be more involved in my youth group. I found a person to like talk to as like a church friend that I could confide in. And then kind of like what the pastor is saying, as I started to talk to God more, he became more real. And so like, for example, I'll pray before I study, or I'll pray before I take a test in school. I'll pray before I eat. I'll talk to him before I sleep. I'll talk to him about any problems I have, any family problems, any problems with my life. And then as I started to pray more, I started to see him answer my prayers more. And as he started answering my prayers, I started to believe he was more real. And I think that's the problem with a lot of people today's with today's generation. Like, we expect to see something out of God when we first hear about him, when we first listen to him, or we first talk to him. And when we don't see what we expect to see, or we don't get out of it what we expect to get, we kind of fall away from it. And I think that's one of the main problems we have in today's generation. Like, especially in my life, I can see that happening in my life. So I could see it happening with a lot of other people as well. And so I think the one thing I really want to tell you all, or kind of the one thing I really want to impart upon you all is today's generation really needs a lot of prayer. Because especially since there are a lot of non-believers out there and their influence is really strong. And so if you don't consistently have, like for me, I have a church friend I can always talk to. If you don't consistently have support from God or from your church or from someone you can rely on, it's really easy to fall away from God. And that's, and then eventually you'll stop talking to God altogether, and then you might turn into a wrong path and it will all go downhill from there. So I just ask that we all pray for those people in today's generation, or in any generation really, who know God but feel like he isn't necessarily there. I hope they find God where they are and they'll turn back to him. And that's all I have to say. Who wants to go? I don't know what to do with these, so I'm just going to give them to you. I hate hearing my own voice on mic. Okay.
You have to hear it anyway.
I can't look at everybody either. I'm going to have to stare at the screen. Okay. Okay. I don't really want to speak into this thing. Okay. Hi, I'm Belinda. I think everybody knows me. Well, okay, not really, but so yeah, the whole second generation Christian thing, like, really applies to me because I'm also an elder's kid. So a lot of my Christian life has been like really stuffed up with knowledge and pretty lacking in experience. And okay, I'm just gonna read off of here. I don't remember exactly when I was born again, but at some point I started having a desire to seek God and experience Him more. But I think in my seeking God, it was mostly just like I would always have this really specific question that doesn't have a specific answer. And then I would just keep thinking about that and expecting Sundays and like the Bible and everything to answer that. So my current one is this. Maybe this is like the unpopular opinion or like the other side of the story, but yeah, I do realize that this world is so bad, but I get really tired of hearing it a lot, and especially from my parents. It's just like, oh, video games are so evil. Satan's in like the games and whatever. And it's like, okay, but it's kind of annoying because when I hear that a lot, I'm thinking, you know, it's not, maybe there's some things that are unique to like this generation, but it's not like I've ever lived in another time period. And then human nature itself is pretty sinful. And like, I guess, even though I've heard this a lot and I'm starting to get like, oh, it sounds like the same old stuff again. But I've become really aware of this sin, I guess. But okay, so what I wanted to know and practice is that even though this is the state of the world, like, so what? Because I still need to seek God and evangelize in it. There's that Bible verse that talks about being the light and the salt of the world. So we're not supposed to let the world influence us, but we're supposed to influence the world. Or I guess God will work through us and influence like other people. And I do realize that being a good Christian in this generation is like walking on a very thin line between staying on track with God and being swayed by the world. And sometimes because I'm so like stuffed of knowledge, I'm unsure of exactly where that line is. It's not that I get swayed by the world, and I don't feel like I've ever dared to go too far from God. But I guess we do live in the world anyway. And my greatest struggle recently is that sometimes these things I hear and then all the knowledge I carry with me, instead of making my faith stronger, it makes me really uncertain about my life. Like, I feel like I don't know where I should be. Like, I think about where I am, like what I'm doing. And it's like, just as an example, like every single time I play video games or something, I'm thinking like, is God disappointed in me? Or like every time I'm talking to like my non-Christian friends a lot, it's like, is God disappointed in me? That's kind of the vibe I get from these messages sometimes. And it's like, I don't think that's correct, but I can't help but feel that way. So I guess in this uncertainty, God wanted me to seek Him more. And every once in a while, He did give me some like really, really big encouragement. I've seen twice now someone close to me in my life become like completely transformed by the gospel. And I'm not saying that their testimony is my own, but my Christian life has been a lot of knowledge, and sometimes it's really intimate and sometimes it's kind of lukewarm. I've never gone too far away from God that I would experience something so extreme, but I feel like God like used these people to like show me His power. Or like, even though this isn't exactly like my story, I got to witness all of that, or like how God can really change people. And I guess like I had a friend in high school who maybe I mentioned going to church like once, and then I was like, we just listened to a message and then hang out, so like I don't even know what I said, but none of the credit was really mine, and it was only God that could change people. And so I had been praying for these friends, and it's like God answered that prayer and another one that I was like, I had this uncertainty that whenever I was in the world, there's a difference between like in the world and then being influenced by it. I didn't really feel like I get influenced by the world that much, but then these messages always make me think twice about that. So like that's what that uncertainty comes from. So then I'm like, I don't know, I'm always just thinking like, you know, when I'm at school, every time it's like not Sunday, you know, am I still close with God? It's just, it's weird because I feel like maybe I should be that much closer, but I'm not. And then especially when I'm with my non-Christian friends, or like when I'm playing video games, for example, it's like, I just hope that like God doesn't look at me and think like, you're on the wrong track. But I guess because those things have happened and I've like thought, you know, maybe the point of going to that high school, I always say that I hate high school, so I'm not gonna talk about that too much, but I would just like stay up a lot and play games, and like I hated it because they gave too much homework. But through that, I actually like watched one of my friends become someone who was like really lost and like always searching for answers, and finally like he found God and he just like became a completely different person. And I was like, okay, maybe that's what made it worth it. Maybe that's why God planned for me to go that way. So in the end, it kind of felt like, yeah, maybe I was on the right track all along. And even if I wasn't on the right track, then God still made something out of it. So I was like, even though we walk in this world, like God still exists and he's still with us. And okay. That, yeah, no matter where I would go, it was God doing work in my life that evangelism could happen. So even when I felt like I was too close to the world, yeah. But these messages, like so far, have been really encouraging. Like the whole, you know, don't be afraid to get your hands dirty, or like when you confirm God's truth and rely on him, then he becomes like more and more real. I guess I expected a lot of Christian life to be like, you know, I would just ask God a really specific question or get a specific answer. Be like, okay, what's next? Like, where am I going? Is this right? Is this wrong? But it's not always so black and white. And I think that he does that on purpose, because if it was so black and white, then I'd just be like, okay, here's my answer, I'm done. But if I like, if I don't feel like I have a complete understanding of it, then I would want to go to God more and more. So I think I answered all the questions, except for what brings you to this conference. I like Pastor Vincent's messages. And yeah, he's really like relevant. and like, I guess especially this one really answered a lot of things that I was thinking about. And like this whole thing that I wrote was kind of just like that, I guess. Just going into the world with like the armor of God on. And I'm really thankful that God actually showed me results, because it's very encouraging. Okay, I'm done.
Well, hello everybody, my name is Lisa. I hope you can hear me in the back. I'm from Cleveland, and most of you probably don't know me. I visited the DC church 2 years ago in their summer conference, and I saw how God was moving in Pastor Li Che's conference. And so when I was invited back and heard of this conference, I was really excited. And I've also heard of Pastor Vincent's messages, Chinese and English, on YouTube. And I was like, wow, I really need to experience this in real person. And so thank God I am here today with my mom. And I just want to thank you so much for giving me the space to share a little bit of my experience with God, as well as how this conference has been for me. And so I actually really didn't know what this conference was about. I just felt God leading me here. And so when I received the paper, it said the chaotic era. I'm like, wow, that sounds like my life. That sounds like that sounds like my mission field. And I sort of chuckled to myself. And to give a little bit of a background of where I was at and where I am today. So I recently graduated school and I started work. And during my school time, I was very driven, very ambitious. I was doing a lot of leadership activities, extracurriculars, starting my own business. And I was building my own kingdom. And so one day I was late to an event and I was driving my minivan to school. It was raining extremely hard. I was driving probably 95 miles an hour. Yeah. My mom knows about this already. So I was driving, there were three lanes on the highway. I was driving really fast. And then I realized, wow, I can't really see the car in front of me. I should probably slow down. So I was tapping on my brakes and I passed the bridge and all of a sudden my car spun. So I basically hydroplaned. And what that means is like your car is on water and not, it doesn't have traction on the ground anymore. So there were five cars around me. This is on a Saturday afternoon. I spun across the middle lane and I was moving backwards in front of a red car on the furthest right lane. And so I was just staring at this, it was a middle-aged man, he was balding, I remember. We connected with our, we saw each other in the eyes and we both knew what we were thinking. We're thinking, any moment now, we can die. And I don't know what else is gonna happen. And so just so intuitively, my heart just cried out like, God, I cannot die yet because I have not done enough for you with my life. And right after that prayer, my car automatically like spun 90 degrees, and I just landed in the patch of grass where the merging lane was. Like, so I didn't hit anybody, and that was a miracle. So anyways, that is a quick background story of where I was and where I am today. So my mission field, I am actually working in consulting right now, and it's really hard to explain. I basically sit on planes twice a week, fly to a random city, work there for multiple days, and then I go back home. So that is where God has called me to be, and that is completely, utterly chaos. Because there are so many uncontrollable variables and influences, not only in that lifestyle, but also in that career. In my career, I see so much of the superficial, what the world deems to be successful, the fame, the status, the money, the power. And so I see the chaos. I'm living in it. And so coming here, I just wanted rest, rejuvenation, and I wanted to be empowered to go back into my mission field. And your message this morning was a complete confirmation of what I have been experiencing professionally, personally, and spiritually. I always say, like, when I was praying this morning about what to share, the first thing that came into my mind was spiritual warfare. It sounds crazy, but it's so real. And when I was praying about what to share, one of the first words that came to me was deception. And this is what chaos is, right? I Googled the definition, and it's complete disorder and confusion. And that is what Satan wants us to experience, right? And like what I shared before, what the world deems to be successful, that is a deception. Your motives, like always challenge yourself. Why am I doing the things I'm doing? Why do I believe in the things that I believe in? And always go back to the truth as your baseline to judge those things. And so, like you shared in Romans 14, the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. And so, like, when we are living life, like, what are we pursuing? Are we pursuing our own kingdom, like the kingdom of this world, or are we pursuing the richness of God, right? And then the second thing that came to my mind was the importance of discernment. So amongst this chaos, it's so important to understand God, His Word, and His Spirit, because we cannot trust our emotions. We cannot trust our minds. We cannot trust our hearts. Our hearts can be deceiving. So what can we trust? And that is the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and the truth. And so putting on the armor of God, that's like my everyday. I always tell myself, I dress myself for work, but do I dress myself spiritually to go out there? And it's so easy to forget to read the Word, because life is busy, right? And then when you're young, you're like, hey, I have so many more fun things to do. But imagine this, you're going out there to your battlefield every single day and you wear everything. You wear the entire shield of armor, but you don't bring your shield. Then you're just in defense mode all day, right? And we are created and we are empowered to fight for God's kingdom. And that is so true. So it was deception, discernment, and direction that I received. And when we hear him and we are able to discern what we experience, then we are able to follow him, follow his will. Because direction is so important. Confusion, deception is all about you just walking around in circles. Like you're not following God's voice. And lastly, that increases our devotion and dependency on him. And this is like a constant everyday cycle that I try to live through and live by. And yes, that's what God shared with me. Some of my struggles that I experience. When you are living in chaos, it's really hard to find rest. And sometimes when work is overwhelming, it's hard to find rest. It's hard to be fed physically. I know my mom has lectured me a lot about that. But I always remind myself, like, spiritual is priority. So even if I, pulled out all-nighter for studying or didn't allocate my time correctly to spend time with the Lord, like, being spiritually fed is first priority. And spending time in prayer to rejuvenate, to connect with him is the reason why we should be, is the reason why how we should be living every single day. And so my prayer is that I do find rest and time to rejuvenate in him and to build my spiritual man, to mature more in spirit, be in the word, and to carry that like double-edged sword every day wherever I go. So, thank you.
Hi, my name is Joanna. I'm a friend of Alan, Mary, and Margaret. I'm also a friend of everyone who came with us, but they've all left. So I'm the only one left. Alan asked me to, he didn't ask me. He picked me to share a little bit of my story this morning. And I just want to let you know I'm traumatized by a large group, so excuse me if I fall over or faint. It's normal. So I'm really encouraged by hearing the three girls share their story. Alan gave me a set of questions that I was supposed to answer, and it seems like they did much more than that, and I didn't prepare a lot more than that, but what brought me to this conference was, I guess to give you a little bit of background, I am very thinking heavy, more than emotionally heavy. I tend to process things in my mind before my feelings. I tend to be alone more than being with people. My idea of a vacation is sitting in my room by myself. So I'm very introverted. That's how I clear my thoughts. That's how I process things, is to be alone. But I'm learning these past 3 months more and more how important community is, and how important it is to have that accountability in the community to help you stir affections for the Lord and to constantly remind you of truth in your walk. And I just want to share a little bit about that. Because I'm alone a lot of the times, I'm very prone to apathy, to falling into dry periods. Like what Pastor Vincent was sharing last night, the inclination of the heart is to just get lukewarm and to get kind of lazy in your Christian walk. When you hit walls, you just kind of like, I give up. that's it. And that's very much me. And I want to say I've been a long-term student of this, of falling into apathy, falling into just lukewarm Christian life. And every time I fall in, I always ask myself, was that real? What I experienced, was that all real? Was God real? Did I really experience it for myself? Am I really saved? So this has been going on my whole life, just constant like ups and downs. And recently, like the past 3 months, I went through it again. So I'm in this like big slump where it's like, I don't want to be around people. I'm just going to give up church. I'm just going to give up friends, all these things. But it was so different this time around. And I'm realizing as I look back, I'm realizing every time I fall into this, trend, God has been showing me grace, showing me that I need him, that this is I need dependency on him. And so this past 3 months has been so different this time around, because I wasn't like, oh, am I saved? Oh, like, what's going on? Or like, I give up. It wasn't like that. It was, you know, every morning I wake up in the morning with no desire for the Lord, and I pray, you know, God, this is who I am. I'm prone to wander. This is who I am. So weak, so defiant of your rules, and this is the world in me. And as I pray that, you know, the Lord reminds me, you know, but I am sovereign. You know, I, your Lord, I am sovereign. I have chosen you, and I have marked you as my child. And even though you let go of me, I'll never let go of you. And so every morning I go through this during the past 3 months. And you know, it's like funny because like I get this revelation in the morning, and then I look over at my Bible and I'm like, no, I don't want to read the Bible. I'm like, no, I don't want to pray, no. So it's the same apathy, but it's, I really believe it's God's grace really that kept feeding me truth. You know, go spend time with your church. Go spend time with your youth group. Go spend time with other leaders. Go spend time with your parents and your friends. And here and there, you know, I open up scripture, and it's so good every time. But my heart's inclination is, no, I don't want to read. No, I don't want to pray. No, I don't want to serve. I just want to be in my room. But every time I wake up in the morning and I do my devotional, God reminds me, you know, your life is not yours. Your life is mine. And, you know, what do you say to that? No, you can't say no. You say, thank you, Lord, that it's not mine. You know, thank you, Lord, that, you know, it is you that is in control of my life, that it is you that's sovereign over my life. That's the kind of grace I've been experiencing the past 3 months. And so this past couple weeks, I have been having a stirring affection for the Lord, which is very rare for me because I'm not very emotionally expressive. Yeah. And so it's been a very new revelation, a new experience for me the past few weeks. And so some of the struggles I've been having with having this new desire for the Lord is now coming out of my comfort zone, as Pastor Vincent was sharing yesterday, is, I guess, not to the extent of like going out and evangelizing, but for me it's like, even like coming to this conference was like, oh no, I don't want to come. Like even going to church and sticking around after church to hang out with people is big deal for me, because I never do it. And but God is graciously giving me that desire. You know, I serve in the youth. I serve in our church's newsletter team. I've been meeting new people here and there. And not because I'm like going out and like finding new people, but because, you know, God presents you an opportunity and you just say, yeah, this goes along with what God wants for me, and God, I choose to obey, and you know, that's why I'm serving, that's why I'm at church, that's why I'm here, that's why I'm up here sharing. So I don't know if any of that made sense. But really, that's something what I struggle with, is just being even around people. And I almost do want to say I do have like an anxiety type thing when it comes to people. And but you look at all of that and you say, you know what? You know, knowing God is better. Experiencing what the Lord has for you is better. You know, and I'm gonna share a verse, but it's like the verse of my life. But I really do believe it, and I guess a prayer request for me is that I would continue to seek the Lord over my desires, over my dreams, you know, over what I want to do, over human aspirations I would desire, knowing the Lord and what He has for me, because I find that to be the most effective and the most, like the best way to live the Christian life, is not going out and doing all this works, but really, like Alan was telling me, Pastor Vincent was saying, you know, your right leg is some faith and your left leg is works, and you just balance it out. You balance it out and you seek the Lord in that way. And, so the verse I want to share with you is in Philippians. It says, Philippians 3:8, "Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For His sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know Him in the power of His resurrection and may share His suffering, His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead." And this is my prayer for my life, and you know every Christian in this room, or everyone in this room, is that, you know, everything, your comfort, your own rights, your own desires will become nothing. Your accomplishments will become nothing compared to knowing God. And you know, if someone like me, someone weak and is closed in and isolated like me, can experience and know the Lord, and to go out and talk to people and share her story, I believe it is the power of God, and I believe that it's for everyone who believes. So yeah, that's my story. Thank you.
Right, thank you so much for all your sincere sharing, okay? I think as with young people, we have gray hearts, but our head is black and white, okay? So in that sense, I believe we speak truth, okay? When we are composed, we really speak truth. I believe every word that you said, okay? Every struggle that you went through. Okay, so I'm going to just comment a bit in the sequence that you have shared. Okay, Sarah. Okay, I thank God that God helped you to find Him back. All right, even you're so confused about your belief. And I think the timetable for you now, and as if what God had for you after this conference, is for you to be grounded in the truth. Right? And God has used people, environment, and in your lives to bring you to Him. But it is the truth that you have in you that will be able to help you process the will of God in your life. So I pray that after this conference, you learn how to think through the truth. Think through. And for that, you need to be constantly equipped with the gospel truth. Okay, you need to be constantly equipped with that. Okay, it's not going to be an easy thing, and that's why I have a sense that if you find the right people, the right brethren with you, okay, they're not just encouraging you to make you feel good, but they can encourage you with the truth to help you think right. It's going to be very helpful. Okay? Can Ellen do the job? I don't know. Come again?
She's in North Carolina.
Yeah, North Carolina. Yeah. So, but I mean, you do the job, you're here, you can call her wherever. Encourage her. I mean, everyone who comes to this conference, okay, someone must follow up. All right? Okay, and you need role models, you need people of your age that can help you in that sense. All right? Left hand, you came with your friends, parents?
With my brother.
Brother, okay. So I pray for you, okay? Find good role models. If you cannot find me on Facebook, okay? I will help you. And Phil, I see you next year. Belinda, I think there's nothing wrong with playing video games. Just that probably there can be more things to do, okay? Plus video games, okay? So nothing wrong with that. Nothing. I know your struggle, okay? You have asked a lot of meaningful questions. And it shows, the question that you ask shows that you are genuine in your faith. I'm very sure about that. But the only thing now is you got to learn how to process the truth out of it. You can ask 100 questions, but if you have no answers, you know, it's going to make you more confused and more conflicted within yourself, okay? But it's a process that you are going through. So I would say now, don't believe your feelings so much, even though you are having a lot of it, okay? Don't believe. And I think sometimes when you are in this process of growing up, Christian family, and you know a lot of truths, right? Your head get very big, you know, but when you cannot live it out, now, you have to appreciate there will be shades of gray in our hearts. That's why God gave us the Holy Spirit. Am I right? Okay, the truth is black and white, right there. Okay, I know this is the thing I must do, the norms of Christian life, you know, I should not think like that, feel like that, you know. Now, this is what you have in your head. But the Lord is not going to lead you like that, you know, just black and white. The Lord come to you with the Holy Spirit and tell you, you know, this is the right time to play games. This is the right way of living. This is the process you may be going through. You know, give the Lord time to show to you. Keep seeking. What I mean is you must keep seeking. The Holy Spirit speaks to us personally, individually. And he knows, I mean, God created every one of us differently. We have different interests, you know, different phases of life, you know, different parents, the kind of thing. And God is going to be very relevant to you if you keep seeking him. So don't give up seeking, even when you have no answers to your question, okay? So be a seeker, okay? For your case, if I'm your parents, I'll just put you in a deep pool for you to learn how to swim. Yeah, let you swim, okay? Just with a little bit of guidance, okay? If you need a little bit of guidance, find me on Facebook also, okay? But I'll just put you in a deep pool. You have a world to see, I feel. You have a world. How old are you, may I ask?
20.
20, very young, okay? You still have a lot to see. So keep seeking, even though you have a lot of questions. Everything will be reconciled one day. Okay? Right? That's what I have for you. And Lisa, okay. I'm so thankful that you see your working field as a mission field. And I think that's the spirit of the remnant. Okay? That's the Daniel, David, Joseph of this era. And you have defined chaotic rightly. That's what I have in me when I put down this title, okay? So it seems to me you can see and sense deceptions really well. So now, for your case, it is about putting on the full armor and living it for your case. Okay, you have known enough. You know, the spiritual dark forces and all, how it's consuming you and all. So What you need is, I give you three things, okay? If you want to be a witness for the Lord in your working fields, you know, you already have that purpose in you, now you need relevance. And the Holy Spirit will give you that, okay? And so that's one thing. Keep listening to the message and keep praying by the truth, and then be with people, okay? So the Holy Spirit works that way, okay? Feel. You have to feel people. You know, it's not, you're not going to just be successful, you know, one off straight. You're going to meet a lot of people, but you got to feel people. Okay. Second thing is, you need an anchor point. You need a good church. Or same thing, you need people who can give you good advice. Anchor, you need anchor point. Daniel has three friends with him. Okay. So, and then the third thing is, I hope you can see bigger things, even outside America. All right, learn to see bigger things. If you don't know what I mean, you can learn from Alan and Mary. They went to Penang. Why did they go? Did they tell you? They say because they have seen enough of this American Christian culture, so they want to get out from this culture to see something different and feel something different. And I want to invite you to Penang next year. If you want to come, you like to travel, you like to fly, come. And I brought Christine, Caleb, and me, and Pastor Sarah's children, you know. Christine, you know, she graduated with an honors, good honors. She gave up a job, go back to Penang, take a low pay, work with dyslexic children, and then go on with that. Just because she wants to be in the church with the mother to be trained as a remnant, she's envious of those who is growing, you know, spiritually. So eventually what happened was, you know, something happened in her school. And she started off with like a small teacher, just a teacher, an insignificant teacher. And then something happened in the school, and then people left. And now she's made the supervisor, she's promoted, and so she's taking charge now. And all. No, real things happen like that. You need to see that kind of evidence, okay, with people who really take steps of faith in their lives. You're not far, okay? You need to see bigger things, all right? That's what I have for you, okay? And Joanna, don't worry, you don't look traumatized, okay? It's good to be living in solitude. I think probably your depressed problem has become a blessing for you, such that you continue to stay while your friends have left, and so that you can receive the best of this conference message, okay? I love your honesty and your sincerity. I have people like that in my church also. Then, and they have learned to love themselves for who they are. Now, I think your ups and downs has a purpose, has a great purpose. First, it has made you understood what is grace, sovereign grace. God has made you like that. God is sovereign, yes. That's why you can be brought into his kingdom, even though you struggle so badly with how you feel. All right, that's one thing. And second, with your ups and downs, as you become more perceptive, you will start to see there are many people in such state, pitiful state, and they don't have the gospel. And you are commissioned to help these people. Okay, this is my answers for you, all right? And next I want to say, okay, I know you cannot control how you feel, but don't be shaped by it. Feeling that way doesn't make you more of a sinner. I have seen people or Christian who are always feeling very high emotionally, but they are going nowhere either. You're not worse than them. In fact, when you are struck by those feelings, yet you still go on following the Lord, doing the right thing, great is your reward in heaven. Amen to that?
Amen.
Okay? And so Last thing, you gave the verse on Philippians 3:8. Indeed, I count everything as loss, as compared to knowing Christ and his surpassing power. That was one of my favorite verses. Okay. Now, since you give that verse, let me advise you. Yes, you cannot control how you feel, but you have no right to live for yourself either. You are called by the Lord to glorify him this way. And take it, pray through it, and live like that. And you will see, you know, it all has good purpose in the end. Amen? Okay. So I have for you, right? Great sharing by four of you. Thank God. Okay. I can feel all of you guys are genuine, sincere people. Okay. You're telling the truth now. Okay. And I appreciate that. Okay. So now we've come to the end. Okay. We have 5 more minutes. Just now, Sister Huiling, you know, told me that some parents brought some cakes for their children. But before that, we want to have photo taking, all right? Can we just, where are we going to have our photo taking? Here, right here, in front, or in the back?
Outside.
It's going to be very cold, okay? Or can we do it there, behind the pillars? Or can we do it outside? No. It's not going to be a good picture because if you have the light coming in from there, okay, it's going to make your face quite dark. Any objection? Just 5 minutes. Huiling, 外面可以不可以? 外面这个地方? 嗯。Okay, 好. Okay, we're just going to process, we're going to proceed outside, okay? 在哪里? 你说? 外面, okay. Just endure the harsh weather, go out, okay? This is the spirit of remnants. Okay, just go on out. Just 5 minutes, everyone move together, move fast. So we get on with this, okay? No one go to the toilet, just go on out now, okay? And then we come back in again.